Transition, the process of changing from one condition to another.
We are now at a new crossroads where change is evident once again.
What does not serve us must transform us anew.
Returning to our original state of oneness and true nature of that which created who we truly are.
Confusion was the way of the past. Enlightenment is the way of the now and future.
We now bring you the transformation of the two who started as one. Our fearless planet never stands still.
Earth has been in a process of transition. Not exactly this remarkable upon now.
Welcome to Transition Radio.
Well, hello and welcome to Transition Radio, live from the land of enchantment, Silver City, New Mexico.
Monsoon City.
Monsoon. Oh my God, we're in the process of trying to move and pack and all that great stuff. And it's just like, okay, we have to go back in because it's like,
yeah, we can't flooding get even cleared out yet. Because that rain is just incessant. It won't stop.
Monsoon season.
Did you make your ark already?
Yeah, it's almost built. And they seem to love it here. It's like, oh yeah, let it rain. You know,
I know.
Yeah.
I'm like, no, bring make it stop. We need more rain. It's like, okay.
Anyway, my name's Mark.
And I'm Lena.
And we soon will be married.
That's right.
See the Mrs. Cummings over here. Less than 2 weeks.
That's right.
Very excited. And tonight's show will be the last show for the next month because we're going to go on a sabbatical. We're moving, getting married, and all that great stuff. But before we end the season, I guess, we have an amazing guest for you tonight.
That's right.
His name is Isaac. And Isaac is a 20-year-old trans-identified man who has been in transition since he was 8 years old. He studied film and gender studies in Hampshire College, where he learned to take a critical stance on medicalization of trans identity, placing focus on the effects of gender-variant children.
After co-facilitating a group of these kids, along with two child psychologists, for 3 years while he was in high school, he spent his early years transitioning, vlogging for the YouTube community, but decided to delete his YouTube channel since he felt it no longer reflected his current views of his gender or transition.
He's currently taking time off from school and is living in New York. And now welcome to the show, Isaac.
Yay. Hey,
thank you for having me.
It's a pleasure. We were very impressed on the documentary provided by PBS Frontline, Growing Trans, and we knew we had to have you on the show. So thank you for joining us.
Thanks for being on with us. This is going to be a great interview, for sure.
So New York, why New York?
Why not?
I grew up in New York. I love it here. It's also just like where I have a place to stay, and I have a job, and all of the people that I know are here, and hopefully this is where I'll sort of spend my life.
So you basically have grown up in New York.
Yeah. It's definitely like a great place in terms of the mindset and the type of people that I want to be around. But you know, it's also a melting pot, so to speak. So, you know, you get a little taste of everyone.
So how accepting is New York of trans individuals?
New York's like hugely accepting of trans individuals. Like there's a really big trans health clinic pretty near where I live that I go to, and you know, there are queer community facilities in lots of different locations. It's an urban area, I guess, so it's just sort of more liberal, maybe, than other less urban places, maybe.
Oh, yeah. Well, you mentioned in your bio that you've been in transition since you were 8 years old. Can you elaborate on this?
Yeah, sorry, I've been in transition for about 8 years.
Oh, for 8 years, okay.
Yeah, since I was like 12. So I, from in my experience, I kind of cut my hair and was dressing and acting male and sort of presenting as male far before, or not far before, but like a good 2 years before I was, you know, claiming I'm transgender. I am actually male in some sort of distinct, rigid way. But I think for me, I cut my hair, and at the time, you know, when you're 10 years old, you don't really look different if you're male or female or whatever your body is. So when I cut my hair and look in the mirror and you see sort of a boy looking back at you, and I was just like, wow, this is great. Like, this is this whole new world of opportunity of who I want to be, and people like immediately start treating me differently, and it just felt like I had kind of landed in my right place. So I guess after about 2 years of living with that, naturally I decided to kind of take it farther with the help, of course, of like my parents, not so much my like school, but you know, my family and close friends.
It's kind of foreign to me what's happening now with the trans youth versus what took place when we were younger. And sometimes I wonder if it's almost excessively being pushed, and people that aren't actually trans are being placed in the trans box, and they're just gender-varying individuals that need to be allowed to be who they are without actually fitting in a particular box. How do you feel about that?
I think it's difficult because on the one hand, I think that's the case in so far as this term is being presented as a normal part of people's vocabulary now, and it's an identity that's not super foreign. And for young kids especially, when you're trying to work these things out, but it all kind of needs to be translated and worked out by the adults who are taking you, in certain very small, you know, niche communities and areas, that is the much easier route to take than to explore a more variant or androgynous or, you know, different gendered life. And it also, I think, makes more sense to cisgendered parents in some way. And because it's kind of, or at least when I first started presenting as trans, it was really pushed as gender identity disorder. And it's sort of, you know, you're putting a name to this really difficult experience. And it makes sense because it's like one or the other. And like, oh, I just have switched. It's still like a binary. And I'm just like, I'm on the wrong side. Or it's like only really one idea that you need to understand, which is that there's one sort of mistake and you need to change that.
Right. So, but do you feel that it's just, you know, that it's the right thing to do, that every child that, a boy that wants to play with dolls or a girl that has a lot of male inclination should automatically be considered trans and automatically be put on blockers? I mean, the reason I ask this because we're seeing this exodus taking place right now, and it's kind of alarming. It's very alarming to a lot of parents that don't want to go that route and feel like they're being pushed, because it's like, if you don't fall for that narrative, you're being considered transphobe, hateful.
Mm-hmm. No, that, I mean, it's always a difficult thing, because on the one hand, I agree with a lot of what you're saying in that it is a huge wave of these kids, and yeah, if you kind of have doubts, then there is this label of like bigot or transphobe that's put on you. On the other hand, like, these kids and the parents are put in a position where the other option, which is really kind of like letting your freak flag fly and like, you know, really just not doing what the world expects, not even in being trans or being cis, but in being just like not really gendered or like not participating in a gendered world, like that's not really an option in a lot of ways, especially for kids. And I don't feel like the like, I don't want to put blame or you know, point fingers at the kids or the parents who are really trying to work with what they have, and doing what I think in a lot of cases they think is best for their kids. I think there's a huge, you know, the world is structured, or at least our Western world is structured in a hugely gendered way. And the place to sort of target where that's an issue is not necessarily in trans people, and especially trans kids.
Watching, I mean, we watch.
We just saw an article by Cosmopolitan that, you know, depicted Jazz Jennings and showed Jazz with a few other, you know, like transgender women that are models, you know, basically and older, and they're asking Jazz about her sexuality, you know, and stuff that, you know, I just don't think it's appropriate to be marketing kids that way. And it's just like, you know, you've got Andreja Pejic, you know, and you got Leah T, and you got Jazz,
you know, 14-year-old being sexualized. And in the same article, I mean, with all these individuals, there's an interview. Let me see if, yeah, it's right there. And they're actually asking her, you said that you're pansexual at 14-year-old. What does that mean to you? You know, and she answers, being pansexual basically means to me that you're attracted to anyone, no matter their sex, sexual orientation, gender identity, everything. There's no limit and so forth and so on. And I mean, I'm kind of a little leery about what's taking place here, you know, with this whole narrative being,
especially
like,
recently.
I mean, you know, it's just,
I mean,
like this
Caitlyn Jenner, and now
boom, all over the place,
all these shows coming on TV, and
it's almost like a product. I feel like Jazz is being used as a product, and these other trans kids are being used as a product. And these doctors clearly say, and we just watched it yesterday, the same documentary that you were on, that they're not sure. I mean, it's basically, we're all guinea pigs. It's bad enough as adults were guinea pigs. Now they're playing mad science with children. That's very scary, because all these medications from Lupron to even hormones have side effects for adults, never mind such a young individual. What are your thoughts on this?
I mean, Jazz Jennings, I think, is an interesting case because she's so strongly been put into the spotlight and from such a young age. Like, she was the first trans person that I saw on TV. And it was really sort of herself as like a public persona was really kind of pushed into the spotlight by her mother, which is a little questionable. This whole thing is a little bit questionable with you know, putting kids so out there and public. I think it makes a lot of sense, though, that like when she's being asked about her sexuality, you know, taken for granted that I think that, you know, she's gonna grow and discover herself, but it makes a lot of sense that she would consider herself pansexual, because at least like in my experience, the longer you go transitioning and the more you think about it, like the more you kind of realize that you become sort of disconnected from gender, I think, in a way. And I think her expression of pansexuality, that makes sense, and that she'd be disconnected in a way from this sort of straight or gay, male or female sexuality.
Well, to my understanding, pansexual, which is what I identify as, is a form, it's like either heterosexual, bisexual, homosexual, and pansexual is one of the latest, which means you're attracted to anyone. What my problem with that question in an interview to a 14-year-old who really is not supposed to be thinking about any kind of sexuality at that, you know, you're still very young, still, you know,
just barely into puberty.
Yeah. And being sexualized is which what I'm seeing. And I personally know Jeanette. She came to me when I was in the Maury Povich show and actually reached out, and I got them the 2020 interview with Barbara Walters, because of an interview they did with me, and I brought them in. And that's, to me, that's always been Jeanette's main goal, because she was a TV producer. And now, I mean, she got what she wanted, but it's like this child, I feel Jazz is still a child, is being exploited completely.
Yeah, I agree with that. I totally agree with that. That's one of those cases where I think it's pretty clear that the parent is in a way using her experience or using her child's experience to make her grow up too fast and realize these things too fast and realize it in the public eye, which is really scary and not what should be necessarily happening, because it makes it so that she really can't make her own decisions in a huge way. You know, whether or not she's old enough to be feeling sexual, whatever, like, I'm not going to say for her. 14, maybe, really sad, maybe not. In terms of hormones and hormone blockers given to these kids, like, that's where it gets incredibly tricky. I think with hormones, it's something you should hold off on. Certainly, hormone blockers, like, it makes a lot of sense that parents would choose that for their kids. Whether or not the doctors are telling the truth or, like, being, you know, totally honest about what they're doing, what is sort of said is that it's reversible. It is marketed as a product, and trans identity is marketed as a product, and that's a problem. But when you're a parent or a kid and you're hearing the option of hormone blockers, it sounds like the most appealing thing. Like, yes, I can just sort of put off this really scary thing for a little while. And, like, to me, that also makes sense, because I needed time to figure myself out before I was sort of forced into womanhood. It's scary because it is, you know, it is putting a chemical in your kid, and you don't know what it's going to do. But it's difficult, and it's such a time bomb. So you're not thinking rationally necessarily. You know, you're thinking within the next year. You know, what are going to be the implications of that?
Now, did they tell you, like, when you started taking puberty blockers? Did you take puberty blockers?
Mm-hmm. I did.
Did they tell you, you know, well, do you realize that you're going to become infertile, that you won't be able to have babies and all that stuff? I mean, was that something that you were rationally able to, you know, decide whether that was a good idea or not? Or did you just go, just give me them, you know, because I don't want boobs, you know, I don't want to have a regular, you know, puberty as a female?
Yeah, you know, they said that was a risk. They really sort of made it clear that was a risk. Definitely more so when I started taking testosterone. The big word was reversible, which may or may not, and of course it's not the case, because whatever you put in your body, like, the effects are gonna happen and they're gonna stay there. But at least that's what's being said. And yes, I was just like, yes, let's take it. But I was also 12 years old, and I wasn't, you know, thinking about having kids. And even now, infertility is not my biggest fear. I think it was the right choice. Whether or not I'll be able to, you know, naturally have kids in the future, it seems like I made the right decision.
It's a scary being in the medical field and knowing exactly what medications do. All synthetic meds have side effects, every single one of them. You hear it on television when they're advertising any sort of meds. But the sad thing is, giving these kind of medication to such young bodies that their minds have not developed. So you're cutting off what is supposed to happen naturally. And puberty is not just about growing boobs and having a menstrual cycle. Puberty is about also developing your mental concepts. I mean, your mind is growing. There's a lot of things that takes place during puberty. And if you halt that, bone density, I mean, a whole large slew of things. So, yes, as a trans person, you're thinking, yes, I don't want boobs, so please make that stop. Or if you're born a man and you're saying, I don't want my Adam's apple to develop, I don't want to have the deepening of the voice. But then we're not thinking about health issues, that when you're taking Lupron, which is a chemotherapy drug, it has a slew of side effects that people have sued the company, which is what's the name of the company again?
Abbott Laboratories. Abbott
Laboratory. Yeah. There's a ton of lawsuits out there. And it worries us. That's why we're campaigning against this vigorously, because we don't think it's the right thing to do.
And I mean, now they're giving kids the Vantus implant, the Histrulin, implant, and that costs upwards of $15,000 to $17,000 for the implant, and it's a prostate cancer drug used from men, and it's really not approved for use on children. And I know that they do these things and use them for off-label use many times, but the dangers are just so apparent, you know, with these drugs. But it seems like the medical community and these, you know, gender clinics and stuff are willing to turn a blind eye to it and, you know, just go, okay, well, we don't really know what's going to happen. These kids are our new pioneers, you know. That's what, you know, Dr. Finlayson from Lurie Children's Hospital said at the close of the Growing Up Trans documentary. And I hope we're doing the right thing. I just don't think that there is enough research out there to turn, you know, these children into modern lab rats, you know.
I can definitely see why that's concerning. I'm not a medical professional, obviously. But I do see why, like, how harmful it could be when you're living in such an extensively gendered world as a kid, where this option is presented, to say, you know what, I'm sorry, like, you're gonna still have to go through these things, and you are gendered. Then the world genders you after puberty. I mean, it does before also a lot, but it genders your body after puberty in a different way. There are medical concerns. I think things, you know, whatever comes up can be dealt with. Of course, it can't be fully, like, processed what that is by a kid. But I don't think it's intrinsically the wrong plan, especially with hormone blockers, because that stops that sort of outside gendering of your body from happening, which I think is really, really harmful.
Yeah, but what about those individuals? I mean, we get emails throughout about individuals that didn't like their breasts or didn't want their breasts developed, but then they turned around, they were happy that they stayed the gender that they were born as. I mean, we believe that's a very small amount of population out there that are actually considered trans, or they're actually either have some form of intersex condition that would warrant this. And the way that I've seen this explode, it's almost has become a fad that a parent much prefers to have a transgender child than a gay child, a very feminine boy or a very masculine girl, and they rather have them fit in societal box. And that to me presents a bit of a danger, because you're playing with people's bodies. And what happens when you get to be 35 or 40 years old, and from taking hormones so long and from taking the blockers, your mind didn't develop, all of a sudden you have some sort of neurological mental issue, some devastating cancer or any sort of disease, then, and all at the end, when a lot of people have detransitioned after having transitioned for 20 years, they go, you know what, this wasn't at all what I thought it was, and they detransition back to the gender they were born as. So now these parents went through all this with the kids and have harmed their child. I mean, that's what worries me. And it's like,
it just seems like these kids are able to, you know, by taking puberty blockers, they're able to hit an escape button on life and become whatever they want to be. You know, I mean, like you were talking about, you cut your hair at 8 or whatever, or 10, and you looked at yourself and you saw a boy in the mirror, and it's like, so you're going to be able to give me puberty blockers and I can be a boy now? But like what you said in your interview, you said it's like, I wasn't given the chance, you know, I didn't give my body the chance to go through its natural puberty. I have a constructed body now, and I need testosterone. Mark needs to take testosterone now, because he pulled out the, you know, he had a hysterectomy and a mastectomy and just got all the ovaries out, everything, and basically can't do estrogen. Yeah, so now he's stuck. You know, he has to do.
Yeah, because when I was female, I had a lot of problems with my natural occurring estrogen. I had fibroids. It's like my body did not react to estrogen well. I have a what they call progestin induced sterilization, which, you know, I've always had like tumors in my uterus and things of that nature. So when I transitioned, it was almost like a lifesaver for me. But at the same time, now it's been 12 years, you know, like I said, I've always felt like an imposter because I used to go back and forth, female, male, when I was a teenager and stuff, and even as a younger child. And, but now when I tried stopping, because, you know, it's like, I don't want to be on the stuff anymore. It's like, it's almost like it feels wrong, you know, and I'm afraid of, to get cancer. I'm afraid to get any kind of disease. I'm 51 years old. When I tried stopping, I started getting very sick. And I know I can't put estrogen, and estrogen is, synthetic estrogen is just as bad as synthetic testosterone. So it's like, I feel like, what did I do to myself?
It's like pick your poison.
Sure. I mean, just sort of rewinding a little bit in terms of sort of hitting the escape button, so to speak, on puberty. You know, I think that's actually kind of a great option. You know, hitting, you know, taking antidepressants is hitting the escape button on, you know, what your mind was sort of supposed to do. And any sort of intervention into how your body will function, you know, without it is hitting the escape button in some form or another. This is maybe a little bit extreme. But again, I think that where I would sort of go with that is that there needs to be, within the trans community and outside, and in the way that we talk about it, an awareness of how it's, like you said, how it's profitable and how it's not really entirely our decision. I think there needs to, you know, there needs to be spaces for kids where you're not immediately gendered. So that could involve like different ways of training teachers or whatever. But I think that it's not going the right direction to say, look at these parents, they're doing the wrong thing, or look at these kids, they're doing the wrong thing, or these, you know, adults. Because for me, I consider myself trans because I know from my experience that this is the way that I'm most comfortable living my life, and this is the way that I feel confident, and this is who I've existed as for a long time. Whereas I felt really sort of pained by the idea of being female or presenting as female when I was younger. Whether or not that would have changed drastically, honestly, I don't think it would have. But I don't know right now. I know that I'm kind of happy with this identity, and I am comfortable with what I'm doing for the most part. I do at some point want to slowly wean off testosterone for maybe a couple of years, if that's possible. You know, I want to take time to reconnect with myself in some way or another. I was actually just off testosterone just because I had my old provider retired, and then I was in school for a while, and then I came back, and it just, there was a mix up. So for the last few months, I actually just started taking it again 2 weeks ago. And while I was off of it, there was no drastic negative effect of being off of it, in my, you know, for me, with my body. The things that I guess could change. I had less of a, you know, intense sex drive, and my face cleared up a little bit, but I didn't like it sick or anything.
Right. So do you feel that this transing of children is being pushed by an agenda? If not, explain.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think so much transing of children is. I think there's an agenda, especially now that it's something that's in the public eye, and it is an industry, to say that this is definitely the right decision, and there are other options, I guess, that aren't being explored. I think there's a much bigger and stronger just gender agenda that's been the case for forever, that's far more harmful to everybody, not just to trans people. That is essentially creating trans people and making it so that we have to turn to these physical alterations of our bodies and really not be okay with one gender or another. So just misogyny in the world and living in a sexist culture and living in a culture also where men are really repressed and can't, that aren't taught, they're not taught to express feelings of fear or you know, deep feelings in general. I think that's the really harmful thing. I think that as far as there's a trans agenda, I think there are certain people in positions of power that are doctors, pharmaceutical companies, etc., who are making money off of it. There are definitely people in the media who are able to profit from, you know, seeing like, whoa, trans kids and you know, whoa, Caitlyn Jenner. But I don't think that the trans community at large has this sort of plan for people. I think if you're you know, when you interact with people in the trans community, it's a very open space in a lot of ways, and there's a lot of openness in terms of people who, you know, so people can be gender queer or gender fluid. People's experiences with gender are heard and respected very frequently, and there's a movement so that it's okay to be a trans guy who is feminine or gay or be a trans woman who is more masculine. I feel like it's almost better in terms of what I'm talking about, in terms of there being this strictly gendered world in the trans community. It's less so than outside. And especially the outside forces that are implementing their ideas about gender onto the trans community.
What we noticed is, and we've actually heard individuals like Kim Pearson say that they were going to use children to push the agenda further, to create a different face than the typical trans woman who's autogenophiliac, or to prevent all sorts of, in other words, it would soften the campaign by presenting the face of children. And there are a lot of individuals in the trans community, crossdressers, especially with a lot of money, that are utilizing the children and this whole media craze to push their agenda. And that's what we have noticed in the actual research that we have done. And they're now appealing to the hearts of people that, oh, look at this young child, how innocent. Yet what we showed in the beginning of the show, that Jazz is being marketed alongside other adults that are models, and we know what the model industry is all about. I mean, it's a very corrupt industry. They don't care about the models. I mean, they're anorexic, they're pushed, they're pretty much pimped out, and here you have the face of a 14-year-old being pimped out, which no, there's no business. So it's a very alarming thing for me to see, and especially I feel responsible since I brought Jazz to the world, and I know, you know, Jeanette very well. And it's just, I'm looking at other parents are like looking at this like, ching ching, we can make our, you know, our child could be the next poster child,
yeah,
as well.
That, you know, I mean, not to make this show about Jazz or anything, but the fact that Jazz has been, you know, such a critical component to modern trans kids and everything. And, you know, I've seen, you know, specials and other stories about trans kids saying, and I watched that Jazz interview on 2020 and it inspired me, you know. And maybe Munchausen moms, you know, out there are like, do you want to be like Jazz someday, you know, and stuff like that. And it's really sad because there's so much more to this issue than just, you know,
and gender.
What's happening?
There's Asperger's, you know? There's neurological problems that are not being seen. Even in the documentary you were in, what was her name? The young
Ariel.
Ariel. You could tell there's definitely something neurological going on with her.
Well, why aren't the doctors diagnosing?
And they're not diagnosing
other
this.
Things,
yeah.
Other than just the gender dysphoria. I mean, you know, yeah. Ariel, you know, can't stand still. You know, is constantly fidgeting. and has definitely some autism spectrum deal going on, you know. And, you know, we also noticed that just on our own personal observations, and, you know, Mark and I both, you know, we have like lazy eyes, you know. It's like, it seems like
this one goes this way, and it's like
so many people that identify as trans that have these kind of similar
characteristics, which all stem, as again, I'm a medical professional, and all stems from neurological issues, but the doctors aren't looking at this right away. The easy route is trans them, you know, give them blockers, give them hormones, but then they're not looking at the major ordeal. And then at the end of, let's say, 10, 15 years, you still have these issues and the person's still depressed and they're still committing suicide even after transing.
But they don't want to give them blockers yet. I mean, as much as they want to give them cross-sex hormones at a younger age. I mean, the Netherlands said, you know, 16 is the number where you should start. And now doctors are going, No, let's push this down.
12 years old.
Let's push it further down.
Yeah.
Where's it going to stop? Are they going to start giving cross-sex hormones to kids that identify as trans as young as 5? I mean, I don't know.
Well, they're not going to give hormones to anybody who would not otherwise be going through puberty. But in terms of parents being, as you say, you know, Munchausen parents, I don't, like, I know there are cases of this, and I know that, you know, it's big right now. I think if you talk to a lot of the families, which I'm sure you have, you know, they're the good and the bad, but, you know, in my experience working with the kids and the families, nobody's going into it saying we want our kids to be on TV. Or nobody I've met. People are coming into it with their marriages breaking up, you know, with huge financial stress, with, you know, huge psychological, and they're doing what doctors are telling them and what the media is telling them. So they're doing what seems to be the right thing. Whether or not it is will maybe become more clear in the future. But you're seeing parents really on the brink of a disaster with their kids, and it's a time limited disaster. You have only a certain number of years, if that, to sort of make this big decision about what your child's body will be and how they're going to be gendered by the outside world, you know, as a person in a body, as a body. I'm not on the autism spectrum. I know a few trans kids who are. Most people that I know who are trans are not. Perhaps there are things that could be looked into. In fact, I'm sure it's fairly likely that there are other issues when you're having these, you know, these big problems with feeling like there's something deeply wrong with your body. And I'm sure that in a lot of cases, the question of being the wrong gender is just, it's not really the case, because I don't think that anybody is really the wrong gender. I don't think that's how gender works, but that is how it works, I guess, in the world, and that's how the world works. You know, you are one gender or another, and it's really, really difficult for these parents to understand what to do. Still be in that world, and to be in the world that they know, and also make it so that their kids who are starting to see this stuff and see these, you know, these opportunities on the internet and on TV and in movies and whatever, they're seeing this as an identity. And it makes a lot of sense that there are a lot of people who are going to relate to that, because I think that when you see the option to kind of escape your gender, it's very appealing. Gender is horrible. It's a really, really, really horrible system that's imposed upon everybody. And this was sort of one of the first ways that was accepted for people to escape that. I think as we move forward, hopefully, ideally, there will be more nuanced ways of doing that that aren't medicalized in the same way. But I don't think it's an issue of you know, parents wanting their kids to be famous or wanting to make money off of their kids.
Well, yeah, we're not saying that everybody, but we're seeing a majority, a large number of individuals doing this. My question is, though, or not even a question, a statement, I guess, is like, trans people, or not even that word, because that word is just brand new, but two-spirited people, gender-varying people have been around since ancient time. Parents have dealt with that, and everyone grew up, everyone had a life, everyone either lived in the LGBT community, or it was gay, lesbian, bi, whatever, cross-dressed, did whatever they had to do throughout the century. Now, all of a sudden, there's this dire need, I mean, it's like, emergency, emergency, we must give your child this stuff or else, you know,
transition,
and it's like,
or die.
And all these suicides, and we did a show Tuesday on how they inflate these statistics and how they lie. So basically I'm saying is like, what does puberty blockers really do? Because they already have their minds made up. You know, it's really nothing. And it really hasn't been tested to know that it really does block much of anything, you know, and how it's more harmful than good. But I'm rambling here, but basically this has been around forever. Now all of a sudden there's this dire need. I mean, you said gender is not important. So why can't people just express and just be themselves without having to hurt their bodies, take dangerous chemicals, and try to fit into a perfect little box?
Well, I didn't say that gender is not important. I said gender is not, I said that gender is harmful. It's terrible. It's huge. It's one of the most important things in the world. It's one of the most powerful forces in our society. It affects everybody.
And it shouldn't. It really
should. It should not. It absolutely should not. But the people who are kind of experiencing these feelings of wow, this is harmful, like this is a harmful label that's been put onto me, don't necessarily, they're, you know, you're not going to quickly be like, oh, it's the fault of you know, a gendered society, because it's presented as at least right now, when there are like medical options that are widespread and accepted, you see a way to still live in the world and to not question a huge you know, foundational structure of society, and move out of, or do what you think is moving out of the gender that's been harming you. But really, a lot of the time you're staying within a gendered structure. And I think the problem is when people think that transitioning is helping them with gender in any way. Because I don't think really it is. I think maybe it's helping you with yourself. Maybe not. But ultimately what will really help you with gender, or with troubles you have with gender, I think is recognizing what it really is. What gender really is, which is something kind of outside of you that's imposed upon you, and taking control of that. And for me, part of the way that I take control of it is in being trans and inserting my trans identity. I also, you know, I don't speak in terms of my body being wrong in some way, but I think it's, you know, I also do want to live in the world, and I want to, you know, study film and do kind of things that aren't distinctly about gender, and being a gendered person. So the way that I can, I guess, evade that sort of, you know, making my body a statement and making my identity a statement, and at the same time be like, you know, gender is this really awful force that I don't want to be a part of, is by asserting a trans identity.
So what made you change your views and shut down your YouTube channel?
Well, I like to say, when people ask me, like, when did you discover that you were trans or whatever, I think for me the biggest discovery that I made was realizing that gender is, in a lot of ways, you know, I don't know the full extent, but gender as we know it, at least, is socially constructed. And realizing that was a huge epiphany for me, because I realized if that's the case, and if gender isn't so inherent and you know, stamped into a person from birth, then that hugely shakes what I thought was trans identity. That was when I was about 16, and I started, I guess, becoming more involved with sort of the kind of more like radical political kids at my school, the feminists and the people that sort of talked constantly about privilege and about social justice. And I also read a book called Delusions of Gender, that I forgot who wrote that. I don't know if you guys know. But it really kind of opened my eyes to how much I was overestimating the, how much gender is kind of inherent in a person. So around that time was when I deleted my YouTube channel because I started, I guess, seeing fault in there being this narrative that's really upheld on the internet and people that kind of video blog their transition and record their transition in this way where it's like, now I'm starting testosterone, now I'm changing my name, you know, now I'm following this exact sort of pattern of everybody else and I'm just, you know, sort of doing this thing where I'm just regendering myself as opposed to breaking free from that construct. So I had a problem with that. Also at the same time though, there was this big movement with the YouTube trans community that was, you know, people sort of saying, I am trans even though I'm gay or even though I wear dresses or whatever. So it's not that the YouTube world was completely, you know, didn't have at all the same ideas as I did, but I didn't really want to participate in that structure, I guess.
So you're into film and gender studies. What got you interested in this?
Well, film, my dad's a filmmaker, so I grew up kind of watching a lot of interesting movies and probably when I was about a senior in high school, was when I started really kind of getting excited about looking at moving images and just how, you know, how beautiful movies and film could be as an art form. Gender studies kind of felt like sort of the natural next step, you know, becoming more informed about what created trans identity, what gender is and how it works in the world. And then the two kind of naturally came together when I was taking a course on women experimental filmmakers and also one about queer film. It's this space in art and in, you know, popular media and culture where deviance, sexual deviance, is both constrained and flourishes in different ways, I guess. You know, that's a whole other conversation, I guess. But like John Waters, for example, Hairspray, very, very popular movie, is turned into this huge popular franchise and is a super deviant movie. And John Waters is a super deviant filmmaker. But then also more in art and experimental film, it's just sort of a very exciting place where people create these, they recreate their bodies in film in a lot of ways or show bodies in film in different ways. So like Rosemary's Baby, for example, I think a movie where a body is shown filmically in a way that it couldn't otherwise have shown, a female body.
Excellent. What was your experience working with gender variant children, and how do you feel about them being pushed into the gender box?
It was a great experience in that I met a bunch of really smart, really great kids who I, you know, loved and had a great time with. It was difficult working with psychological and medical professionals, who I had a very different idea of how the sort of the group should be run. And I guess they were really going by this narrative of needing to move into medical transition, and they had doctors there constantly, which was really helpful for the parents, because the parents could be like, oh, phew, like this is something we have for our kids, but not so much what I think the kids needed in that space, which I thought was more a space to, at an early, from an early point, start thinking about gender and critically what it is and what it is to them that makes them so upset with that structure, that construct. But aside from minor disagreements, it was interesting kind of reconnecting with what I was thinking at their age, and especially talking to the kids that weren't really just like distinctly trans, but who were kind of there because they were showing some gender variance. I can't actually say what specific things happened, but it was really rewarding and valuable for me.
I wanted to share one of the, I think it's a little clip that Frontline had with you. And here we go. What happened to it? There we go.
Testosterone is a super fun drug in some ways. Without doing anything, you just grow like more muscle. It gives you this sort of, this deep booming voice and all this extra hair that you can play with. And I have a lot of fun with my testosterone the filled body. I think it's a blast. Just like looking in the mirror and like moving my Adam's apple or whatever. It's really exciting because it's this.
We're having a little hiccups here. Yeah. Why is it doing internet that? World. Bummer.
Let's try doing this.
It's live TV.
Live TV for you. Let me see here.
My testosterone, the filled body. I think it's a blast. Just like looking in the mirror and like moving my Adam's apple or whatever. It's really exciting because it's this form that I wanted, and now I have it and I can play with it. There are also definitely downsides to testosterone. When you start taking testosterone, you kind of stop crying. If I feel something now that at one point would make me very sad, it almost like translates.
I don't know what's going on, but well, we did try sharing the video.
Usually it doesn't happen.
And
like
usually
that.
It doesn't happen like that, but I don't know what's going on. It's because it's on Facebook. Usually the videos are on YouTube, and it flows a lot easier. But that was a very, it appealed to us. I mean, we watched the entire documentary, and your whole excitement about the change, but at the same time, which is, I wanted to actually play the part where you talked about feeling like a constructed man, and that you felt that, you were
cheated from having your regular
puberty. Do you still feel that way now, or do you feel differently?
Yeah, I feel not so much like a constructed man. I think every man is a constructed man. I'm just a man that has sort of constructed myself, which is great. I'm all for that. I feel like my body is constructed medically, and it's a choice that I make and continue to make. And if I had any like huge issues with with that, I think I would, I would stop. I'd stop taking hormones. But it's more that I'm troubled with the gendering of bodies, or at least the way bodies are gendered, especially, right now when it's an option to capitalize off of people who struggle with gender and who in this, who are kind of the faces of where the gender construct fails. The way that we're put back within that construct is by changing our
body. And maybe that is because it's really funny. Frustrating not to be able to cry.
Oh, it's playing. Hold on. It all is not to start playing. Go right ahead.
So, unlike, I guess, as men, I've been put in this position where the easiest thing to do was to build my body up so that I could do want my plan is maybe after I graduate or maybe at some point if I'm more settled to take a little time off of testosterone, work out what it means to be, for me, to be a man, to be a trans man, without it being so focused on what I'm doing to my body, because that's been how it has been since I started, really. And I don't think it necessarily has to be.
Yeah, and I think that's where we have a problem with the medical community pushing their poison or pushing their potion, I guess you would call it, that it really doesn't allow you to look within yourself on who you truly are, like our ancestors did, that they felt they were two-spirited, or they felt more inclined to feel more masculine if they were born female, or more feminine if they were born male, because all these drugs and all these surgeries are actually taking present. They're like in the forefront, and people really don't get to know who the person is. People don't really get to experience, like you just said, taking that sabbatical. Like, I've stopped testosterone on various occasions. And, you feel differently because having been born female body, feelings were something that were very much a part of who I was. When you start taking testosterone, you almost stop feeling altogether. It's hard to cry. You become this other person that's really not you.
Yeah, that's like how my emotions manifest themselves has definitely changed a lot. And for me, I actually, maybe it's a good thing, I really, really hate crying because I just get a horrible headache whenever I do. But but I'm still an incredibly emotional person. Emotions affect me, insofar as how much I'm affected by emotions, it hasn't changed at all in regards to how the emotions manifest themselves. There's a difference. I don't think it's really, I don't think anything's been stolen from my experience emotionally. But I agree with you that that there is a huge problem with the medical options being pushed as kind of the one way of presenting your, non-normative gender. And that's just the result of gender being tied to money and, being tied to forces of power that can make money off of medicine. Who knows what would happen if this, were regulated without money being involved. Maybe there would be more of an open discussion, but the fact of the matter is that it is, and we need to sort of take the responsibility to have conversations about what it really means outside of our bodies and our experiences with our bodies to live as a gender, or to live in a gendered world.
Just like they did in the old days, Joan of Arc, and just a ton of people that lived expressing the gender they felt in their heart without having to hurt themselves, It's really sad.
Well, in your opinion, are gender specialists really armed to deal with what's taking place this exodus of transitioning?
I don't know. I guess it depends on the specialist. The person that my therapist or the fellow I've been working with, I actually think is incredibly intelligent about this stuff. Sort of has a really open mind about how this all works. And before I got my surgery, you know, I kind of called him in a panic, being like I'm really excited. I'm super happy, but I'm really worried that I'm gonna. That this is, you know, I'm afraid to say that, like, I might be worried about what this is gonna do to my body, and like, I'm afraid that I'm gonna, you know, find these scars like monstrous. And he sort of brought up, like, he was the first person to say, like, you can do this, and it can be the right decision, and you can still have feelings of fear and of, you know, some just regret to some degree or anything, because you're sort of taking this into your own hands, but it doesn't need to sort of define your experience, I guess. There are also gender specialists who I think really are just like, it is a disaster if you don't let your kids transition, if you don't fall into this box, into this gendered box. And they're not equipped to do it, but you know, I'm not going to speak for the entire profession.
What I'm looking at, because, you know, as an occupational therapist, my background is very strong in psychology, and I'm seeing that these so-called gender specialists were almost like thrown into this mix without having any knowledge, because obviously this is something that's very new. It's something that's pretty much been fabricated. I tend to believe the word transgender and gender dysphoria really have just been words and diagnoses that have been created to push surgeries and hormones, and gender specialists are the frontline leaders that have been put there to make this happen. I have worked strongly hand in hand with a lot of gender specialists in the beginning of my transition back in 2003, led a lot of seminars, did a lot of panels with them, and they were pretty much shooting at the hip, which I still believe this is taking place right now, because this is a very new science. People still don't understand the normal function of hormone on regular individuals. So I tend to be a little, what's the word I'm looking for? Suspicious and leery of gender specialists, and they're not really looking at issues that they need to look at. And I don't think they're equipped to do so, frankly, in my humble opinion.
Yeah, sure. I mean, actually, I should say that the guy that I work with is not a gender specialist. He's a gender specialist insofar as, you know, he's written books about gender, not about trans people or about this phenomenon, but actually about gender and its function. And he does work with a lot of queer people, but he's not a gender specialist. I agree with you. You know, I think anything that's making money off of trans identity, and like distinctly off of trans identity as opposed to gender in general and exploration of gender, I think is a problem.
Definitely.
Well, can you tell us about you, Isaac? What makes you smile, cry, etc.?
I don't know. I guess I like talking about this stuff. It's the only thing that I feel like I really know about. But I don't know. I guess what I like humor, and I like people who are nice to me. But other than that, you know, I don't. There's not that much to me.
So there's not much to what makes Isaac tick, what makes Isaac excited.
I guess good movies on projected film.
So your career. So in your words, what do you think is happening that there are so many gender-varying kids now versus in the past? Because all of a sudden, I mean, we even did a show once. They're talking about that, you know, Sigmund Freud would have loved, I mean, he would have loved to have been the inventor of like this gender identity stuff with kids coming out. And, you know, and there's nothing written, nothing in the records written about this taking place. psychologists, psychiatrists would have given their arm and a leg to have come up with this. And all of a sudden now, you know, it's like, yeah, we have all these like gender variant kids who are saying they're born in the wrong body. You know, in your own words, what do you think is taking place? Why all of a sudden it's like, woo, we've got this mass exodus of trans kids coming out, you know?
Yeah. I think it's a mix of things. On the one hand, I think there is sort of more of an openness in regards to, you know, being gay or being yourself or being queer in some ways. It's becoming more accepted and it's becoming more taboo to push against it. On the other hand, as soon as it started even looking like that was becoming okay, it became a place where money could be made off of it. So that definitely, you know, that's had a huge effect on how transitioning is seen and how many people do it, because people are going to be okay with it if they can make money off of it, I guess. But there isn't a huge exodus of people coming out there and saying, like, I don't want to be gendered. I don't want to participate in this, or I want to push against it actively, against the construct of gender, because no money could be made off of that, because it's required for how, you know, how money making works in the world. I think that's, I guess, the next thing that we can hopefully see in terms of there being like a true genuine acceptance that's not kind of you know, written in the media and capitalist culture and whatever.
And we did a show a while back called Transeugenics, and this has kind of been in the making for quite a while, where they're trying to get rid of what they consider the undesirable, which has always been the gay, the lesbians, you know. And to me, this has been a move that's been going on for a while, that, okay, let's sterilize the individuals that we don't want, the undesirables. And if we put them in a box and they kind of fit the look, and
just like they do in Iran
right now,
where, you know, they ban homosexuality, but they, you know, pay for surgeries for trans people.
So it's like, you know, people call it conspiracy, whatever, but it kind of, the way we're seeing this major, I mean, it's just like every day you have a new video on a trans kid transitioning, everything is like trans. So it's like, it's, to me, it's been something that's slowly being pushed for a while to eliminate, you know, the whole LGB, or at least kind of put it off in the corner now that they've gotten the rights to get married and everything else. So it's like, you know, maybe it's cynical of me to think this.
We were talking to a trans, you know, parent of a trans, you know, child, you know, an FTM, no, an MTF.
Last night.
And the child, you know, well, it's not a child, it's 22 years old. We're like older, so
we influence a child to us.
Yeah, but and no offense, but you know, the fact is that, you know, this kid is now, you know, totally identifying as trans, whereas they were identifying as gay, and they're extremely religious and they're extremely Catholic. So this fits into the Catholic mold, because the Catholic Church hasn't taken a stand on transsexuality, whereas it has taken a stand on homosexuality. And it just, like, it feels like, you know, I mean, the gay community and the lesbian community is being, the numbers are dwindling there.
It's being erased.
And they're being erased.
We get a lot of, we have a lot of supporters that are feminists and they're lesbians, and they feel that they're literally being, like, removed, and that all good women, lesbians, are turning trans, and, you know, they feel abandoned. They feel like, what's going on here? You know, and I could understand, you know, I feel their pain, and I love my feminist and lesbian sisters. And, you know, in my awakening as of late, I no longer consider myself even trans or a man. I find I am a cis woman. I was born genetically a female. I'm two-spirited, have partial intersex because of the progestin induced fertilization that I have, you know. So I could understand where the concern is, where all this is heading. And it's kind of scary because it's almost like, are we really eliminating a certain group of people and creating another and then creating sterilization?
I don't think that you need to really worry too much about there being a full elimination of queer people. I think there are always going to be gay, lesbian, queer folks. I think trans identity, as it often is, and as I see you guys sort of pushing against it, is a very sort of straight thing in a way. To me, I see it as very straight because it's so ingrained into a trust in the binary. So I don't see trans identity as a threat. And I think that, you know, I've read these sort of articles about feminists who I would consider myself a feminist. I guess there's sort of question about whether or not I can do that as a male-identified person, but I would say that I am. I've definitely read a lot about feminists having, you know, taking issue with trans identity. And I think in the way that issues being taken with trans identity, it's ultimately taking issue with the construct of gender in general. Like, if you really look at the root of the problem, it's not trans people. Trans people are being affected by the same problem that feminists and, you know, people who don't want to subscribe to gender as it exists in the world. That's what feminists are facing and what gay and lesbian people face too.
And this leads me to the next question. How do you feel about the arguments and battles? And there's a major battle between trans women and the feminist movement. I got caught off in the line of fire when I interviewed Kathy Brennan, and I was attacked vigorously by trans women for doing that.
Yeah. It's complicated, especially when it gets into this sort of issue with Caitlyn Jenner and the like, you know, people who have a ton of money and a ton of power asserting their feminine identity. While I don't think that her being trans is like a blow to feminist struggles, I can see where questions would arise about people who have had a male gendered experience. So insofar as the world genders them, it's entirely male up to that point. Insofar as they don't feel like that works, maybe the right way to do that for them is transition. And I can see where when those people are in positions of power and are part of the force that is defining womanhood, that being the media, you know, the fashion industry and Kardashians and stuff like that, I can see where that would be an issue. But I also think that my number one thing about this is that I think that it's wrong to put the blame on trans individuals or to pin these struggles on trans people who face the same sort of violence and discrimination, if not more so, than the people who are, you know, making these claims in general.
Well, it's not so much putting blame on trans people, but there is, I mean, I've been in this battle for 12 years, and I've known personally hundreds and hundreds of trans individuals living in Wilton Manors, Florida. I had tons of trans friends, both FTM and MTFs. I've interviewed hundreds of people from all over the world. I've gotten emails from all over the place. So I don't hate trans people. What I dislike is what the movement that I've seen that has changed since I used to advocate. What I'm seeing now really scares me and concerns me. And then it worries me that other trans people aren't seeing this because they are so dazed and so zombied out in what they're doing that they can't see anything else. It's just a tunnel vision. And that they're using children and that they're not looking at their own health all to fulfill something that in reality can never really be fulfilled.
All you can ever be is a constructed body.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, all I could ever be is a constructed body of some feminine expression because I was born male, you know, and even those that do take the puberty blockers, even those that do delay that and are able to not have the big hands or the Adam's apple and all that, still, you know, when it comes to at the end of the day, I mean, Mark and I found each other by a miracle, you know, to be together, but there are lots of lonely trans people in the world. And one of the biggest reasons is because they can't pursue a relationship in a way that would be gratifying to either individual, because simply, you know, if they've removed their ovaries, obviously, you know, or they have a fake, you know, a phalloplasty or something, or if, you know, or if they have a vagina that's fake. I mean, it's really a constructed deal, and there's no like legitimate reason for it literally being there other than to satisfy your personal, you know, quest for finding that, I guess, that gold at the end of the rainbow, that treasure. And you get it, and I've noticed that there's many NTF friends that I have that, or used to have anyway, that, you know, they get to the end of the rainbow and they have SRS and they're still lonely
and unhappy,
and they're by themselves.
Yeah. And it's like, what have we done doing all this? In the end, you can run and you can hide, but in the end, you're still there, you know? And it's like one of those things that, what are we doing? Is this really the path that will find us happiness? If a person wasn't happy to begin with, they're not going to find happiness in doing this, because gender is not everything, in my opinion. You know, if you have problems before the transition, the problems are still going to be there. And I think a lot of people think that magically someone's going to wave a little magic wand and they're going to be happy because they had their genitals changed and they're on hormones. And that, you know, you find happiness for quite a while. It buys you 10, 15 years, 20 max. After that, you know, you're faced with reality.
And yeah, I mean, I think it's, you know, it's very sad that there are so many people that haven't been able to find love or be satisfied in a relationship or be happy with themselves. I'm very happy with the way that I think of my gender, because I kind of gave up on that idea of there being an endpoint or even the word trans, like going from one point to the other, like that's not how I'm trying to live. I think, you know, it's wrong to think that that's actually how it's going to come about. I think if people can kind of come to realize what the benefits of transitioning actually are going to be, you know, what the sort of power that you get to take in your own gender and how empowering, I guess, that is, like, that's great. But no, yeah, you're right. It's too bad when other problems are overlooked, and when the pain of being like in the wrong body kind of takes precedence. But I don't know if it's so much the case that that we're destined to be, you know, male or female. I don't think that I don't think that there's so much truth in what we're born. Like, maybe what I'm doing now isn't true either, but I don't think it's any more real than my femininity or femaleness. Also, I think I don't think that trans people are really unable to find love. Like, I most of the trans people that I know are either in relationships, have been in relationships, have pretty normal lives, so long as they're kind of happy for the most part and feel like they're in a world where they're loved. If you feel loved and if you like yourself, then I think you can, you know, there's someone out there.
Well, what do you mean? I know we've talked about it, but specifically, what do you mean when you say that you feel like you are in a constructed body?
Mm-hmm. I mean, I technically have constructed my body. You know, this isn't what it would be if I didn't have surgery or take medication. I think, but I don't think of it necessarily as you know, a 100% bad thing. I've constructed my body in a way that I feel gives me power over my gender and the way that I show that. So I have some power over this incredibly large force that's looming over my head and everybody else's. The bad thing about that is that I didn't really come to that understanding until it was sold to me, you know, with a different pitch. So I don't like that masculinity in the form of testosterone and surgery was marketed to me and that it was purchased. But I am happy that I get to have this opportunity where I kind of make myself male in this way, and I get to kind of say, I'm not gonna do the whole thing where I inevitably am one gender or another, and I have the choice of how I'm gonna be.
So you had mentioned earlier that you plan to take a sabbatical on testosterone. What is it that you're planning to accomplish by doing that? What is your goal on this sabbatical, and what do you want to achieve?
I have no idea, but I think, you know, I say a lot of this stuff. Like, I want, like there's, you know, I say that I take issue with the medicalization of trans bodies, but I don't totally feel like I could really understand what I'm talking about unless I live for a little while, at least, as a trans person who's not taking medical steps. So as much as I don't want to do that, and insofar as, like, I really like what testosterone does to my body and it makes me feel comfortable, I feel like I also have a very strong feeling about what my gender or my experience with gender is to me, and I want to strengthen that by exploring what that's like without it being tied to my body.
So how does taking testosterone make you feel? What do you like about it, and what you don't? Or what do you do? What do you like about testosterone?
I mean, I like that I can pass as male. That's great. And I like that I can pass as a male my age. I like having facial hair and I, you know, I like being able to play the role of man when I want to, which I do all the time for the most part. And I'm choosing my words pretty carefully, I guess. So when I say play the role of man, that's not to say that, like, I'm, you know, presenting some big lie, but more that that I like to do this. You know, I like to present my masculinity to its fullest. Specifically what I like that it does, like, I like having facial hair. I like being, you know, more muscular than I otherwise would be. Not that I'm, like, the strongest person in the world. And I like having a more aggressive sex drive. I like a lot of things about it. I don't love that I have, like, some, you know, I don't love that I have an entire chance of heart disease and you know, failure or whatever, cancers. And that stuff is not great to think about. At the same time, I think, at least in a lot of ways, like, cis men also have a much higher chance of developing heart disease than cis women. Heart disease, liver failure, problems. So I don't like the idea of being sick right now. That's not something that I'm dealing with. I don't love that it's hugely changed the way my emotions manifest themselves, but I don't really mind so much. To me, it's the right choice, because I'm not really good at being this, like, odd man out. I'm not good at like putting my whole being into defying the you know, the structure. But at any opportunity that I can, I'd like to kind of say what I think about that about the social structure and about the gender construct, even if I don't sort of take the burden of living at every step of the way.
I think where a lot of people have problems with this whole use of hormones, and it's like we fall into the stereotypical, and I noticed that with myself, because, you know, when I was living as a female and I would go into my masculine phase, you know, I was masculine, but I wasn't this typical, stereotypical, you know, alpha male that testosterone has allowed me to be. But at the same time, then we're almost creating the stereotypical world. Trans women do it, trans men do it. And we fail to see that there are many shades of being a man and there are many shades of being a female. And we're falling into this typical construct, the stereotypical boxes. And I think we're hurting society instead of helping society.
Well, we had Lynn Caden, who recently, well, she detransitioned, you know, from being a trans man, and basically told us in a very eye-opening way that, you know, she would shake somebody's hand, for instance, you know, and they would look them in the eye, and it was like, do you really know who I really am? If you were to know who I am, would you accept me? Or would you think that I was just playing a game, you know? And Mark has felt the same way.
From the word go, when I would go into male bathrooms, you know, and I still do, because obviously I can't go to female bathrooms, and I always felt like I didn't belong there. And I always felt when I made friends or new people, I had to out myself because I felt that I was lying to them, you know? And this started happening after the 2 or 3 years after my transition, and I always like questioned myself, and I always felt bad, and I felt that if I didn't out myself, I was lying to people.
And even Skylar 11 has said, you know, in some of his YouTube videos that, well, in that one Growing Up Trans webcast that they did, that, you know, he doesn't identify as a man. I mean, he identifies as a trans guy, you know, and it's like you can't run away from the fact that you're not really a genuine, you know, XY guy.
Right. You know? Whatever that means, you know, it's
in that sense, you know, I mean, there's like no way to change that fact. But when you look at another guy and you shake their hand, I mean, there's gotta be, you know, I know for me, you know, with women, you know, it's like, oh, they're reading me or whatever.
Right. Or, well, it's a thing, you know, the back of your mind, and maybe not so much in the beginning because, or after you pass, you're okay, but then after a while you're like, there's just, I can't explain it. It takes people a while to actually feel that, but people that we've interviewed that detransition all say the same thing, you know, that it comes a time where you like, you know.
I mean, I think that's, I'm certain that that is the experience of many people, and that, you know, some of that rings true. You know, I definitely kind of, when I'm talking to people, I'm like, You don't see it, like, this isn't sort of clicking, but I don't think that I'm lying to anybody. You know, I don't think that, I think that, I understand myself differently than they may, and I understand gender in a different way than they may. It's not necessary for them to know, you know, what, you know, that I'm trans or not. Not that I wouldn't say that I am. Like, I have a public life to some degree. And I want to say what I want to say. But I don't think that I'm lying to anybody.
Let me ask you, you took puberty blockers when you were 12, right?
Mm-hmm.
Did it help stop your development as you would have if you had not taken puberty blocker? Because I kind of like, you're really kind of leery that it actually even works as well as it does, and the side effects to me are a lot more than what the benefits are.
I mean, did you have to have top surgery even though you were on puberty blockers?
Well, I started puberty blockers after after I already had some sort of enough chest growth to need top surgery. But it definitely could have gone farther. Like they were certainly by no means fully developed. Like I didn't need to get, my like nipple size reduced, whatever. It stopped anything else that would have happened. It stopped menstruation. And I didn't experience, at least at the time, who knows what happened in the future, but I didn't experience any side effects.
You said it stopped some menstruation, but you still had some?
No, it totally stopped menstruation, sorry.
Okay. Because it's not something that's really been researched or talked about a lot. I mean, I noticed with Jazz, she still has certain development. She's been on blockers for quite a while. Since 11, and I still see a little bit of, like the size of a hand and certain remnants. And I'm wondering how effective these puberty blockers really are versus, the side effects. How much do they really stop? Because again, it's not like something that's been used throughout history to stop puberty. This is very new. So
I think it stops things that we really, that people are scared of. So, nobody's, unless you're really intensely dysphoric or whatever, like you're not really looking your hands in terror about, people are going to know. In terms of, the big menstruation, breast growth, or I have no idea about the MTF situation, but it stops anything really.
Because I mean, who all of a sudden thought of this Lupron, which was not even invented for this, and right. More of cancer, stopping endometriosis. That we'll give this to a child and it'll stop the puberty. I mean, there hasn't been enough studies, and I don't think there's been enough cases where they know, okay, well, we're able to stop this and this. And I don't know. I just don't think that it's as well thought out and well researched.
I don't really want to come across as, okay, so we're late transitioners, obviously, but we have no qualms about being jealous about you, your age group or younger kids that are able to, transition in a way that would prevent the secondary characteristics from developing. I'm not, that is not even a thought in our mind.
On the contrary, I believe that if I had to do this all over again, I would do it the same way, because my experience growing up as a female was a very unique experience. And I think it's made me who I am today, that I lived 38 years of my life as a female, and then the 38 onwards, I'm 51 as a male, and I wouldn't trade it, because it's such a great tool and knowledge to have walked life and
bring
on both sides. And I feel like parents and the medical community are stealing from young individuals that ability to have had life in both genders.
And that's how it came across when you mentioned that you said something in your interview to the regards of how you felt like you weren't able to have your normal
puberty
growth.
Yeah.
As a teen. And I don't know if that might be why you want to get off of testosterone and not necessarily explore, since the secondary characteristics aren't going to show up, that you want to explore that side of you that you were born as. I mean,
I do, but I've also come to a point where I no longer feel like I'm really hiding from my body. I've done enough to my body so that I feel like I'm more okay with taking baby steps in whatever direction. I kind of really like the idea of hormone blockers for young children who are having serious issues with their gender, because I think that the violence of having your body become gendered as you go through puberty is traumatic to anybody.
But we all went through that, though. We all went through that puberty before there was TV and media and this push. We did it, and it was like it wasn't as traumatic, or else would there have been
not traumatic to the individual necessarily. But I think that the fact that adult bodies are gendered in a way that kids' bodies aren't is bad. Like I have a problem with that, and it's a way to evade your body being gendered in one way or another for a certain period of time. That's like I know that there are risks medically, and I know that it's like a new development and that it hasn't, you know, been available for a long time, but I actually think that's a really positive
development. Have you read the studies that the brains do not develop till they're 20 something years old? That's why we're not able to drink and vote at a certain age. So, you know, seeing how this has been pushed by the media, and that now it's more of an awareness than back in the day when we were just, you know, hey, I like to play with cars and I played with certain things, but never even thought that there was a possibility that I could change my gender. So you dealt with it. You grew up and you dealt with it.
Give young kids lots of psychotropic medications for various reasons. You know, kids, or just like any medication, like, yes, you know, I know that your brain isn't fully developed until you're around 21. I also, you know, I don't think these kids are being left with any huge, huge neurological deficiency. I think, you know, of all of the medical things that I take problem with, I think hormone blockers, it's the least so, because it's not. It's the only thing that's not really putting a gender onto you, or it's not saying like we're gonna define your gender by your body. It's saying that like take some time before you really need to make much bigger decisions about seriously irreversible things that you're gonna do to your body. Whether or not that's how it's being treated, like I know that a lot of people will kind of have this tunnel vision that you talk about. That's an individual basis. But I don't take so much problem with it.
I think that the hormone blockers are actually, they're not even using them a lot. Is it Dr. Olson who's like right away putting them on?
Dr. Olson's putting them on cross-sex hormones in LA.
And what buys you a couple of years? What do you really know different between the time you're 9 years old and you get to be 12 and you're still in a gone home mentality? It's really not holding up any time because you're on like a train that is just like nonstop.
And no, but maybe by the time you're 16 or 17.
Well, they're not even waiting that long.
Though. No, they're not waiting.
We know Dr. Olson was somebody conducted surgery on a 12-year-old.
Yeah.
Rest I would say maybe you don't do that. I'd say that's profiting off of gender structures.
Yeah, and that's what they're doing a lot. 12
but
years
I don't old. Think block profiting off of gender structures in the same way.
Rocky at 14.
That's really the issue that I have. It's less so with this idea of experimentation on children and whatnot. I see why that's easy to take problem with, but I also see there being a benefit to it. And I think that there are other things that are harmful about living in a gendered world that are arguably as harmful as you know, causing slight physical differences.
How about changing the gender world and not changing the body? Like Dirt says, change your world, not your body. You know, let's change society so that people can be people and express themselves the way they see fit versus, you know, cutting, nipping and taking and all that stuff and just getting people to be people without hurting.
Yeah, that's the great thing about hormone blockers is that you're not gendered in the same way when you don't grow into a gendered adult. It's not imposed on you in the same way.
It's the ultimate goal, though. The ultimate goal is to take the hormones. They're just... How many kids have actually been on blockers that have not actually gone across sex hormones?
They just don't.
I don't know. Maybe that needs to be explored further, like as an option.
Right. Because it seems to be like a ploy. Okay, we're putting you on blockers. And
by the time you get on the blockers, it seems like it's been decided.
Yeah.
And you know, I mean, once you cross the line to go into puberty blockers, you can tell us probably yourself better than anyone else. You know, you probably knew other gender variant kids your age at the time that were doing these things and having puberty blockers. How many of them reverted to not transitioning at all?
None in my experience. I'd also say like that it's another thing where, you know, I think doctors need to be responsible enough to say, hold off on the cross hormones for, you know, for a certain amount of time. I'm not saying they're doing that. I think they should.
They're not doing it at all. They're trying to get kids.
Yeah, it's a problem.
Yeah. Even younger.
Exactly. So hormone blockers is really not to buy time. It's just like, well, okay, this is the protocol. We're going to put you on the blocker. And then 2 years later.
The thing is,
it is by then, though. Like, more time needs to be taken. More time needs to be bought. But I think if I were on blockers until I was 18, even, and actually, I think I probably would have still taken hormones, but I still would do that today. Like, I wouldn't have hugely changed what I did. But I see where you're coming from, but I think it's another thing where at that point, the kind of reasonable choices, or what to me are reasonable choices of trans parents and trans kids, are being seen as more of the issue than the doctors.
Yeah. You know, Kyle, in the Growing Up Trans story documentary, Kyle's the kid that, what was it? The dad didn't want Kyle to take, the next steps towards getting hormones and stuff, and was basically, because of Kyle, the mom and the dad were pitted against each other. And the dad stated, I don't know what it's going to look like. I don't know if I'm going to be here. You know, the mom was definitely on Kyle's side, and the dad was definitely not in agreement. And Kyle had some kind of a bad experience at school.
Misbehaving.
Acted out violently.
To get his way.
And then got his way. Yeah. And I find that there's like this sense of entitlement that these kids are pushing on their parents, insisting on them, conforming to what they want. And that's wrong for kids to do that, to pit their parents up against each other like that.
It's not the kids' fault. I don't think it's the kids' fault. I don't think you can blame, 13, 14-year-old kid for messing up his parents' marriage. That's something way bigger than his experience, way bigger.
But that's what's the focal point of the argument, is the child.
People say that my dog having, being a problematic dog split up my parents. Like, it can seem very extreme, one focal point. But ultimately, if you have a weak marriage, you have a weak marriage. That has nothing to do with your kid being a problem child. That said, like, I've seen instances where parents do split up, and the focal point of their split up is the transition.
But if the
I can't say that the kids are at fault. I can't say that these kids are doing anything horribly wrong.
Well, if the kids are actually creating the problem within the marriage because one parent feels one way and the other parent feels the other, and the kid is almost playing like good cop, bad cop, and they're pitting the parents against one another, then of course there's going to be some sort of the structural dynamic in that marriage. And, it's a hard situation all around, but what does it actually solve? I mean, this whole idea of transing individuals so young because of what's being pushed in the media, what's in school. I mean, you've got to admit that it's a peer pressure thing, and there's a lot that's being taught to this youth, and they're actually wanting this without really knowing if that's what they want, because it's what everybody else has gone through, and they see people online and they see the jazz and they see everything. And then,
I mean, the whole idea of puberty blockers is like, well, it puts a pause button. It gives you the opportunity to choose whether you want to or you don't. And it's like, it's like, I don't know. I just think that it's just something that's a little bit over the top.
I think more research needs to be done. I think the medical community needs to get educated. They're right now, they're shooting at the hip. They don't know what they're doing. WPATH, Dr. Spack, Dr. Olson, they're all the same players that are creating this whole dilemma, and they're creating this. They're creating the rules as they go along, and there's really not enough research to say this really works, this is what's really happening. And
what do you say, though, if then there's a bunch of research done, you know, definitive studies that say that the negative effects of hormone blockers are relatively minor?
Are relatively what? You broke up.
They're relatively minor. You know, you're it's not going to cause cancer. It's not going to cause any huge, you know.
But it already has, though. They already have with other individuals that are not trans that have been given Lupron for years that have a class action lawsuit against the company because it is very harmful, extremely harmful. Never mind that it's reversible with
and
as part
the,
as puberty.
The manufacturers of Lupron have stated that Lupron, the effects have not been proven to be reversible when administered to children.
Exactly. And the fact that adults that have taken this have had all sorts of problems and cancers and all sorts of neurological impairment and all sorts of issues.
If you go to lupronhub.com,
and you'll see that. I mean, we've had shows demonstrating this, and then, you know, these doctors bold-facedly say, well, it's this and that.
It's
and the
completely
other.
Reversible.
And it's a lie.
It's not.
You know, it's all, it's reversible. Maybe you could still have puberty, but what has actually lain dormant and hiding. It's like a time bomb of disease waiting to happen. And there's people that only took it. There was one person who took one shot, and it's like miserable right now with all the side effects and health.
Yeah.
And so imagine a young child. I mean,
yeah, that's not the experience of anybody that I've ever met or myself. You know, I think there are risks to anything. You're informed of these risks to the doctor when you're taking them. Yeah, maybe not preventive of them, but you are told documented risks.
Right. But, you know, you don't know. I mean, as a healthcare provider, I've known people who took medication 10 years ago and the side effects now, because it's almost like a time bomb waiting to explode. Things happen, you know, in your body. And as far as cancer, I mean, cancer, you could have what they call an initiator and a promoter, somebody who could have worked in the mines was experiencing chemical reaction from working with asbestos, let's say, and then started smoking. Well, the reaction of both chemicals created cancer later on in years. So we don't know, you know, the side effects of these things. And
it'll be interesting to find out.
30 years down the road, we're going to see a lot of law actions,
class action lawsuits potentially.
Yeah. And it's, and again, and all what for, if we just learn to be genderless and learn to express who we are without having to fit in societal box, I think we would take care of the problem more so than chopping, adding, and taking drugs that really solves nothing in the end. I mean, my opinion, and doesn't, you know, I know you have a different opinion and everybody else has a different opinion. I just think we need to talk more about it. I think that there needs to be a lot more research, and kids should not be playing guinea pigs and being paraded like Jazz is being paraded for money and profit.
But
I think that
discussions like this are really beneficial and helpful. You know, I mean, we obviously don't agree with everything,
and
but
that's fine.
You know, there's other things that we do agree with, but I think the important thing is to let these issues sit on a table finally and discuss them so that we can get something to resolve here. Because instead of pointing fingers and people accusing other people and the trans community and feminist community and all these different communities having, you know, we're all people, you know, when it comes down to it, at the end of the day, we're just a bunch of human beings trying to get along, trying to work together,
trying to live, you know, and, you know, it's a discussion that's not had, because right now the narrative is just the trans narrative. There's no other choices. We get parents calling us, what do I do? How do I make my kids stop this? They've been like programmed and their kids in school and everybody's doing this and they think it's cool. He came out as gay. Now he's saying he's trans. And what do we do? And we're being looked at as bad parents because we're not riding the same train that everybody else is. There needs to be another voice and there needs to be another opinion and people need to talk.
Yeah, there needs to be a discussion, certainly. I think there needs to be serious and like a little bit of serious finger pointing at you know, medical industries, the medicalization of trans bodies. There also needs to be a much larger scale, you know, not just pointed on the trans issue, but a much, much larger scale reshaping of how we think about gender in general. And how we present gender to children. But definitely, I think this is, it's a conversation that's not really had. The question of, you know, is this narrative right? And it's also a narrative that is pretty weak, ultimately. The idea of being born in the wrong body and there being something fundamentally wrong with you that needs to be medically changed.
Because we're not born in the wrong body. We're born in the right body. And it's just...
That's what Jazz is saying in the commercial. You know, I was born in the wrong body.
And no
Janet Mock will say, I was born in the wrong body. Everybody, it's like the trans narrative these days is, I was born in the wrong body. How do you get hormones? I was born in the wrong body. I knew when I was 5.
Yeah.
You know, the typical storyline that everybody knows and is well rehearsed in. And I just think that there's more to it than just being born in the wrong body.
There's neurological issues, Asperger's, all sorts of different things that are being overlooked, and not everyone is meant to transition. And sadly, it's become a fad. And you're seeing a lot of individuals who are actually butch lesbians or gay men that all of a sudden think that this is who they are, and then after they transition a couple of years later, oh, I made a mistake. And there's a lot of that. And there needs to be more, what's the word I'm looking for? More guidelines, more, I can't even think of
there's,
the word.
There needs to be more emphasis on, you know.
More accountability is what I'm looking for than what is right now. You know, it's very easy. And I mean, somebody pointed out to me, all I have to do is give my therapist $280 and she'll give me the letter, one-time visit.
And here's the reality. Here's the reality, though. Mark just had a phone call from a friend who's an FTM.
Mm-hmm.
And what happened to him?
Stroked out, 48 years old. Testosterone didn't agree with his body. He's been on testosterone for quite a while now, and all of a sudden had a stroke. And I mean, not just him. I've had tons of people, Australian, FTM brother, who still has dysphoria, even after having top surgery, not happy. You know, there's just, this is not the cure-all. And that's what people need to realize, because right now it's being sold as the cure-all.
But it's being sold by doctors and, you know, the medical
pharmaceutical
as a cosmetic cure-all.
And WPATH and the trans advocates that have the money, that are pushing this, that are using children. And people just need to think. And that's basically what we want to get people doing, thinking and talking and having harder guidelines. Because right now it's way too easy.
Yeah, I would agree with that. Or at very least, just a different way of thinking about the trans experience. Maybe more than one narrative out there.
Yes. Yeah, that, and you know, realize that these people, WPATH, Dr. Olson, Dr. Spack, all these doctors are all in cahoots. And there needs to be, even with research, there needs to be other people there that are gonna keep them accountable.
Yeah.
Because I know too well, when research is done and it's done by a certain company, and then you know the results aren't going to be fair. So we need to learn a lot more about this, and people need to stop attacking one another. I mean, we've been villainized because we have actually posted a question and we have actually tried to get this conversation going, and we're villainized. We've had death threats, which is wrong. I mean, this needs to be talked about. I mean, I've been trans for 12 years. I've been an advocate for years. I think I have a little say-so in all this, and my voice should be valid. And I've been called delusional and crazy, and I'm my transition was not successful, and I'm not happy.
Yeah.
That's BS. You know, that's BS.
If a trans kid were to listen to us, that they might commit suicide.
I think, you know,
it's like, you know, there's so much more that needs to be said and needs to be done that it's not being said or being done, you know, other than what's the common thread,
the narrative
that people are listening to now. Yeah. Well, we've rambled on,
but it's been great. Thank you so much for this time. And,
yeah, thanks for having me.
And, you know, I think it was a great end of season, whatever we want to call it, because we need a much needed rest. We've been at this for the past 3 months and being attacked. It took one video that we made about concerns about
puberty blocker
and it just went viral, and then it's been nonstop with the hate and stuff like that from the community.
Mark's friends list is a lot smaller
than it was before, and it's like, wow, when I used to be an advocate, everybody loved me and I was the smartest person around, and all of a sudden now, what credentials do you have, and
you
know, and it's crazy, but you know, as you get older, and I'm 51 years old, I feel like an old fart, you start thinking about life differently. And, you know, it's just putting a little information in people's ears and getting people to question things a little bit more and making the medical community a little bit more accountable. Because I've worked in the field since 1992, and it's not all that it's cut out to be. And
yeah. Now, everybody's making money off of this doesn't need to be held more accountable. I agree with you on that completely.
Yeah. All right. Thank you so much, Isaac.
Congrats on your marriage.
Thank you so much. Well, guys, thank you so much for tuning in. We're going to be away till August 11th. We'll resume. Yeah. We're moving this weekend, and then we're getting married in 2 weeks, and just, you know, taking some much needed rest that we've eat, drink, sleep, the stuff, and lots of research and stuff that we do. So we need some time off to think of each other and move into our new home. And
we're going to have a new location for this.
Yeah, new location. So no more RV. So
no more trailer trash rants.
Exactly. Yeah. All right, guys. Thank you so much for tuning in yet again. And have an amazing 1 month away from us.
Yeah.
And if you can't live your truth,
then it's just not worth living.
Not at all, folks. Good night. I got a little heat.